Okay, thank you very much for inviting me. It's a great honor and a privilege. What I will talk about today, the notion of Golden Gates, it's pretty recent. It was coined by the man in the back, by Peter Sarnak. And I think, so it is, PUN is a compact Lie group, which is very interesting for a now theoretical computer scientist. And they are looking for finding excellent generating set in them. And excellent, by excellent, I mean by two things. First, mathematically, which I will explain, and also computationally. And Golden Gates are essentially excellent generating set, the best of them. The term Golden Gates, the gates come from computer gates and quantum gates. The Golden Gates, I think it is related to the fact that Peter invented this notion in Berkeley, and it's related to the Golden Gate Bridge. So before giving you the definition, let me, I want to give you, run you down with one explicit construction, and at the very end of the construction, I will give you the definition. It is an amazing construction which really use a lot of number theory, but it's hidden. So these are what I call LPS generators. People here could see what I'm reading here. Okay, so LPS stands for Lubotsky Phillips and Sarnak. Okay, so the construction is as follows. Pick some prime congruent to 1 mod 4. And define the following finite set of 2 by 2 matrices, denoted by S. So I will. The coefficients are a complex coefficient, but they are actually only comprised of Gaussian integers. And all the xi are integers, and in fact, the first one is a positive integer, x1, and the other ones are even integers, and they satisfy the simple relation that their sum of squares is equal to the prime you chose. And this finite set is, in fact, you can look at it as it sits inside the compact Lie group PU2. You need to multiply by the scalar matrix of 1 over square root of p, but these are a finite number of matrices inside this compact group. And they satisfy the following nice property that, which I will call S optimally covers PU2, which, let me just write the equation and then I'll say it in words. And I emphasize how optimal this property. So maybe I'll try to speak. Okay. So you do the following. You look at SL, the words the generating set S of length L. Around each one of them, you place a ball, BV. This number is V. The ball in the compact Lie group of volume V with respect to some bi-invariant metric on the compact Lie group PU2. Mu is, of course, the Haar measure. So you have a set of points. You put a small balls around each point. You take the union. You ask how much of this covered the entire compactly group. And so, and the claim is that this is essentially, it covers almost every point in the compactly group. So note that this is indeed optimal in the following way. Just suppose for a moment that the Haar measure is a probability Haar measure. PU2 gets the measure of 1. And look at this ball without the polylog factor. So put here 0.99999. Then by just looking at all the balls of volume 0.9999, the number of words around all the words of length L, you see that you simply don't have enough mass in all your balls to cover the entire compactly group. So decreasing this by a tiny bit, by removing this polylog and put a 0.99999, make this statement false. So in this sense, this is an optimal covering. And to prove that this is an optimal covering, it uses several number theoretical results, which are not at all obvious. So let me begin. It uses two amazing results. And I want to start by explaining the more hidden number theoretical result by giving you also another amazing property for this generating set, a navigation algorithm. So here's a classical result, Jacobi 4 square theorem. Jacobi 4 square theorems basically just tell you what is the size of the set S. It works for if you replace P by a different non-prime number. But in our case, it simply says that S is of size P plus 1. Sounds simple, right? Well, in fact, Jacobi 4 square theorem actually hides in it a very rare property called class number 1. So to motivate it a little bit, I want to look at the group generated by the generating set S. So where does this group live? Obviously, it lives inside PU2 as a dense subgroup there. But it actually lives more naturally in a p-arithmetic subgroup. G is an algebraic group, which you can think of as the projective similitude unitary 2x2 matrices with respect to the Gaussian number field quadratic extension and the standard identity matrix. This is our Hermitian form. And this is an algebraic group. Well, if you can also think about it as taking the Hamiltonian quaternion take their invertible elements, think of this as a group over the field of rationals and divide by the center. You get the same thing. I like to think about the projective similitude. Projective mean divide by the center. So this group is actually a finite index subgroup of this thing, of the p arithmetic group of G. And the Jacobi 4 square theorem actually tells you the following class number results, saying that if you put inside this algebraic group the p-adix, then each such element in the p-adic group, I can write it uniquely as an element from the group generated by S and an element from the p-adic integer. And whenever this thing happens, this is, again, this is quite rare. This is a class number 1 result. And this is also equivalent to a p-arithmetic group such as this lambda, which acts simply transitively on the vertices of the Brotitz building. Brotitz tree of GQP. Well, most of you have probably seen a way to identify the Brotitz building or tree with GQP modulo GZP. But the fact that there is a simply transitive group doing that, it's quite remarkable. And using this fact, one can now give, one can note the following. So first of all, one can really think of S as the P Hecke points in GR, which is exactly R compactly group. Or the neighbors of a given vertex in TP plus one when I think about this tree as living inside PU2. Okay, so this is a statement I want to explain a bit. How do I think of S, and how do I think of even the element of lambda as sitting, as describing it? It's not that hard to explain once I told you that I'm acting simply transitive. So remember, lambda acts simply transitive on the Brotitz building, Brotitz tree, but also lambda is a dense subgroup of PU2. So I can really use the element from my group to place them on this compactly group, which is topologically it's just the three sphere. And by the graph structure of the tree, I can draw edges and really draw and graph a tree on the Brotitz on the compactly group PU2, or the three-dimensional sphere. Really draw it on it. I mean, it will cross each other. There is no obvious distance preserving in this drawing, but I can describe this graph. And similarly, SL is the P to the L Hecke points so I can now tell you a simple application of this observation to get. So here I said that the LPS are an optimal generating set from a mathematical standpoint. Now I'm starting to using number theory to get some saying how excellent they are from a computational standpoint. So there exists an efficient. I mean, it may not be interesting to everybody in a number theory seminar, but this is there is an efficient algorithm solving the navigation problem for lambda with the generating S. Navigation problem is also the word problem. Given a general element in lambda as a 2x2 matrix, tell me how to write it as a word. And this is a general problem I can pose for any group in a generating set. And here is the solution. You take your element, you make it, you have some element from gamma. You make it act on the tree. So inside the P plus one tree, you have some vertex V0, and then you have gamma V0, another vertex in the tree. And the question is, I want to write gamma as a word. So look at the tree. Again, remember the tree, I sort of draw it in the sphere, but I don't want to look at it in the sphere. I want to remember the tree structure because it's a nice cut zero space. So look at the tree, and in the tree you can find the shortest or a shortest path from any two vertices. Looking at the Cartan decomposition, you just look at this vertex and apply on it all the different p plus 1 element in S. One of them will decrease you in the Cartan decomposition, then continue it until you'll finish. That's a navigation problem. Okay, and another problem, so I mean, this is a nice navigation problem, but I want to emphasize the fact that I'm identified the elements and the words with Hecke points. This will be important later on. Continuing with this thread of trying to get nice properties for this generating set, let me also mention the approximation algorithm problem. So here's a simple problem. You want an efficient algorithm such that, given the following data, some element from your group, some length, some parameter describing volume of balls, and you want to find some word of the given length which is close to your element provided by the problem, and close meaning that it is in a ball of volume V around G, if one exists. So, I mean, just looking at the previous property, the previous theorem, tell me without any algorithm, it tells me that we know that one such one exists for the LPS generators. Essentially, as soon as the volume of the ball is along the size of 1 over the number of words. And now let me tell you two algorithms, one which work generally, and the other which really use number theory. So the idea is that number theory really plays a role even in such approximation algorithm. So the first is the Soloveikitaev. Algorithm, which works for general topological generators, but it has the downside that the volume of the ball that you need to take are pretty large. If here you expect to find an element, a word of length L, in a ball as small as the number of words to the minus 1, here you have to take in the exponent something that changes with the SL, which is not a very nice property. But thanks to an algorithm by Ross and Selinger, which works for the LPS generators, there is such an algorithm that gives you, well, not the shortest, but considerably better than the previous one. And if the and in some cases it will even, when the original element is diagonal, it will even give you better. Okay, so I'll stop talking about algorithms. I think I'm, this is not the place. I will start tell you about going back to the theorem of optimal covering. Okay, I cheated. I just want to say one little thing. So the reason I mentioned the approximation algorithm is so that I can tell you what is the definition of the what appear in the title. So a set, a finite set S in a compact Lie group like PUN is called a golden gate set if it satisfies the following. S has the optimal covering property. S has a navigation algorithm. And it has an approximation algorithm. So if you have a generating set which satisfies, a topological generating set which satisfies these three properties, then essentially you have an excellent generating set, both mathematically and computationally, and one can use it. And for PUN, we suspect that theoretical computer scientists will use it because they're just better than what they currently have. Okay. So now let me go back to number theory, specifically how this theorem is proven. And the way that this theorem is proven is by using an instance in which the Ramanujan conjecture is proved for this group, for PGU2. Okay. So the actual definition of what do I mean by Ramanujan conjecture, I will give in section 5. But for now, let me just tell you how to use it. How is this used? So let me just say that a weak Ramanujan bound for a pair XT, where X is a compact space and T is some bounded operator on L2 of X. The compact is not necessary, but it's just to make my life easy. So if the following soft bound happens. So I have the operator, and I can look at its eigenvalues. So lambda 1 is its first eigenvalue, and lambda 2 is its second, and I want that the following Ramanujan bound will happen between them. Well, a weaker version of it. I don't mind if you prove it up to some constant and for any epsilon small enough. So this is what is the weak Ramanujan bound, as this is what essentially is needed for many applications, including this one. And so So in our case, when we have the weak Ramanujan bound for all the operators, the convolution operators with this set of points, then we get the optimal covering property. On the other hand, when we can prove a version of the Ramanujan conjecture for the group PGU2 that I described, then we can get the Ramanujan bound that we need for TSL. Something important to note here is that we use the fact that SL are exactly the Hecke points. Otherwise, it's not that easy to relate the from the Ramanujan conjecture a bound for the Hecke for the operator TSL. But we are in luck because of Jacobi. Our SL are precisely the Hecke points of the group, and so we can give a Ramanujan bound on these operators. And the Ramanujan conjecture for PGU2 is proved. I will state it in a minute in a very general way, but let me just mention what does one really need in order to prove it, from which famous result it follows. So one uses, of course, the Lind's proof of the famous Ramanujan-Peterson conjecture. For modular forms of GL2. So the full Ramanujan conjecture for GL2 is not proven, but for modular, for those of them which are modular, it is proven, okay? And modular holomorphic, yes, thank you. And the Jacquier-Langlands correspondence from GL2 to GU2. So we need the full Ramanujan conjecture for GU2 or for BGU2 in order to get the optimal covering. We have a Jacquier-Langlands correspondence from a certain automorphic representation of GL2 to GU2. Surprisingly, all those that goes to GU2 are precisely holomorphic modular. Keep that in mind. I mean, it's a miracle, but luckily that miracle will happen again. Okay, so I just giving you I just mentioned briefly how one can use the Ramanujan conjecture, which I haven't stated, which I will state now, how one can use it to get the optimal covering property. Now I'll explain to you why we don't have it. I mean, I should say, Lubotsky, Phillips, and Sarnak had this, and they would use it, and they have the optimal covering. But I want to go to higher rank for different n, and there, it's not a conjecture, it's just not true. Okay, so in order to explain the naive Ramanujan conjecture, I need to set up some ground notation. So G will be some reductive group over the rationals, and it's automorphic spectral decomposition is as follows. So I can write it as the discrete part together with the continuous part. And the discrete part also breaks down into the cuspidal part and the residue part. And the Harishchandra philosophy, which Langlands extended to all this automorphic language, saying that this is what's interesting for us. So the residue and the continuous come from a cuspidal of smaller groups. Okay, so this is one thing. And another thing I want to remind you is that given an automorphic representation, it has a local decomposition. V are the places of Q. And each one of these pi V are a unitary representation of the corresponding local groups. And finally, in order to state the Ramanujan conjecture, let me introduce the following notation. So sigma V of pi, which is also sigma of pi V, it measures the rate of decay of matrix coefficient. It is the infimum among all sigma greater or equal than 2, such that for almost any pair of vectors, any two generic vectors in the representation, the matrix coefficient is in L sigma of G, V. So it is reductive, and yes, let's don't want to deal with the central issue. Okay, so now, what is the generalized? I mean, let's start with an example. Let's see what happens for the group GLN. It's not an example, it's the heart of the matter. For the group GLN, so what many people believe to be true is that if you take any cuspidal representation, automorphic cuspidal representation of GLN, in any place, then you get that the rate of decay of matrix coefficient is best possible. And the naive Ramanujan conjecture is say our hope that this would have been the case for any group. Why stop at GLN when you can state a conjecture for any reductive group G. And so again, for any cuspidal representation of G, and for any place, we want that the rate of decay of matrix coefficient to be as good as one can hope for. Well, I mean, just looking at this conjecture, you can obviously come up with a trivial counterexample. Take G to be simply anisotropic, Q anisotropic, no parabolic. So you don't have these two factors at all. So even the trivial representation is cuspidal. And the trivial representation for most Q anisotropic groups doesn't have this property for infinitely many places. But let's not take these specific counterexample. Let's hope that this is still the case for groups which are much more similar to GLN, for the split case. Well, even for them, counterexamples were constructed by Howe and Petetsky Shapiro many years ago. So this is false even for split groups. No, the only thing it could be true is for things coming from division algebras, but that's not good for us. So this is completely false, and let me just quickly mention two ways to fix it. Both of them appear in the paper of Howe and Piatecki Shapiro when they gave the counterexamples. So either add a generic condition, and to be on the safe side, don't add it globally, add it locally almost everywhere. Or you need to replace the cuspidal property with a stable cuspidal, which is a term not as easy to explain as a cuspidal. It revolves around the Langlands program, but it has the advantage of being correct. Okay. I mean, no counterexample have been found for the. I mean, okay. So, if you'll find counterexample for stable cuspidal, I think the GRC for GLN is in danger. Stable cuspidal means that you're essentially cuspidal after you goes with the Langlands functoriality to GLN. This is what stable cuspidality means. Okay. Okay, so just a quick recap. We would have liked to have the Ramanujan conjecture. Because it implies optimal covering. But this is a false statement. So instead, borrowing from intuition coming from the Riemann hypothesis, in which sometimes you don't, it's not that the Riemann hypothesis is false, sometimes you just don't know how to prove it, but you can prove.
Every time.
So you instead use a density statement which is weaker than the Riemann hypothesis, but it is just as good for most application. So we want to replace the naive Ramanujan conjecture with a density hypothesis. Okay. Okay, so our setting is as follows. So let G be as before. I'll also put some additional Q anisotropic just to make some set nicer and finite. And I fix some level, adelic level. Fixed level. K is compact, not necessarily open. And now I'll denote by curly F all the irreducible automorphic representation associated to G. Such that they have a k-fixed vector. These are the level k G automorphic representation. So density requires some measurement. So F of t will be those elements in F whose analytic conductor is at most t. T is the analytic conductor. And this assumption is just to make my life easy, to make this a finite set. Otherwise, I'll need to measure the Eisenstein automorphic representation more carefully. And Ft sigma will be the subset of bad zeros, of sigma bad automorphic representation in Ft. These are the ones that the rate of matrix decay coefficient at the place V is at least sigma. So in the LPS case, V is precisely the place where the Hecke operator appears. And now we can state the density hypothesis for the family, for the collection F. So this should hold. I mean, the hypothesis is this holds for any t, for any sigma, and for any epsilon bigger than zero, where here you'll get some constant depending only on epsilon. This is the density hypothesis for the collection F. And just to note that this is just a linear interpolation between the two trivial end cases, sorry, infinity. When sigma is infinity, so you're only expecting to see the finite dimensional automorphic representation, and this should not depend on t. This should be a fixed number. And in the other case, when sigma is equal to 2, then you expect to see everybody. So this is just a linear interpolation and some epsilon for a safety valve, just to be on the safe side. And now, so this is the statement. This is what we will use. If this is true, we will use this as a replacement of the Naive-Ramanujan conjecture, which is false. And what we did was essentially reading and understanding the most recent results in the Langlands program and importing from this gigantic collection of results what we need in order to prove this statement. So as I see it, in the global case, the density hypothesis is a replacement of the Riemann hypothesis that we don't know how to prove. In this case, in this specific case in the theorem, the density hypothesis is not weaker than the Ramanujan conjecture. It is the next generation. Knowing the Ramanujan conjecture really good, knowing how all the automorphic representation behave, we can now prove this type of a result. So I'll tell you what is the input for the theorem. G is a classical Classical mean inner forms of orthogonal, unitary, symplectic, definite mean it is compact, it is R anisotropic, it is compact at infinity, and K is a fixed level, so let me just write the two cases that I can prove the hybrid of them is should also follow, but let me just to be on the safe side. So either you take K infinity to be the entire factor. The two cases that I'm proving are either you're only looking at level at infinity, or you're only looking at level at the finite place, and you don't mix them up. So either this or this is a finite index. So in this case, you take deeper and deeper, deeper and deeper level in taking bigger and bigger conductor, arithmetic conductor of your automorphic representation, but at the infinity it's trivial. And here, the arithmetic conductor is fixed, and what you're doing is looking at representation. Ordered by the maximal weight at the Archimedean place. And this is the case which will be important for the application for the work with Ori Parzyczewski in constructing golden gates. So for golden gates, this will be, KF will be fixed. Okay, and did I give this a name? So maybe let's put here an index of G the group and K the level. So then in this case, this family has the density hypothesis. Okay, and this is this is really using the most recent result in the Langlands program. So to quote from a Michael Harris survey paper on application for coming now from the Langlands program, this really relies on both the automorphic classification of classical groups still an ongoing problem for all classical groups, but we suspect that for certain cases for the definite it should be even more close by for orthogonal groups by the work of Talibi, and for unitary groups in an ongoing project by the work of Kaleth, Minguez, Sheen, and White. So, but this was really a work starting from, a lot of the Langlands program has to do with Arthur, but this is related to his monograph on endoscopic classification. And the other input, which is, so Harry says that there are two successful experiments in the Langlands program that coming to an end. The first is the endoscopic classification. The second one is Shimura varieties. So this is using Shimura varieties, and through that, the proof of the correct generalized Ramanujan conjecture for GLN for the case coming from Shimura varieties, so cohomological and conjugate self-dual. So we now have this density hypothesis for many, many cases coming from classical definite groups. And are starting to collect several applications. Here are just two. So one is that we can construct golden gates for PUN. We can also construct golden gate for other classical definite groups of small rank, PON, SP, and so forth. But for n is small, for n at most 8. This n at most 8 has to do with the fact that class number 1 just breaks down for a higher n. This is for a PUN, for the groups of type PU. This was proven by Muhammad and Golsafidi. They gave explicit examples up to n equal 8 and from n bigger than 9 using the Prasad volume formula showed that this cannot be done. So we are a bit stuck on how to get, we need some another idea of what to do when the genus, when the class is bigger than 1. But more generally, and not restricted by any rank condition, we can now prove that, so in a similar setting, so G is a classical definite group, and X is a homogeneous space associated to the compact Lie group of G. So we can now prove that the PL Hecke points cover optimally X. Actually, they have a better property called cutoff, which I will not get into, but it is much stronger. I mean, it is stronger. It implies the optimal covering property. And we get some other application for a more combinatorial object called the Ramanujan complexes, which I will not describe. But we're now trying to understand how what other application can we get from density hypothesis. I mean, there is a paper of Peter Sarnak that gives other application for lifting problems. And we're just trying to figure out what to do with this huge hammer that we have at our disposal and see when can we assume a correct version of the Ramanujan, write the correct density hypothesis that it implies, a correct meaning one which there are no counterexample to it, and from that trying to see what other application can we get from the density hypothesis, which really you don't need to state any different notion like cuspidality, staple cuspidality. You can avoid all of that. You can just use it as a black box, and that is exactly what we're trying to do. Five more minutes, I'm guessing, for questions. So thank you very much.
Yeah. It's the existence.
No, it's explicit. The search for explicit golden gates, which is very much related to the search of schemes of groups which has class number 1. When you have it, it's the same thing as the one that given by LPS. And one is looking for application a bit more than just golden gates. There is something called super golden gates. And those are we have some construction of them, and there are actually, in order to construct them, we really needed to go to the heart of the most symmetrical object in all of number theory. I'm talking, of course, the E8 lattice. So it is explicit in the sense that we're using all the difficult and most symmetric lattices and construct from them, the same way that that LPS use the Gaussian integers, which are, they have a lot of symmetries, and yeah.
And you don't get up to 8,
We get up to 4, so it's an E8, but it over the unit. No. Yeah, okay, so let me just say that I do know how to say one thing about how the E8 is optimal. Well, of course, there's a lot of ways of saying that the E8 is the best, but you want what you really want is some a group such that this guy, first of all, it's a classical definite group. So this guy is a finite group, but you want this to be to act transitively on the, let's say, the neighbors or, yeah, the neighbors of a vertex, of the origin vertex in the Boitit building. And this is so hard to, this is so hard to build in nature because, I mean, this has a strict bound on the size of these groups, which are known for many time, but the number of neighbors with the Boitis building grows when you're changing the prime. So you really need to take the smallest prime. You need to take the prime 2 or 3. And in 2, you need to make sure that this actually project to this group. Again, for any other prime, there is no way that you would be surjective, but you need to be surjective on this group because this group is in some sense it enables you to go to all the neighbors in the vertex. So you really need to look at how this group on the spherical buildings, and only after that, for application, you need a nice decomposition for this group as well. But what I can say about the E8 is that you won't find a bigger group than the E8. That will be the biggest group. It will be the simple group, like in your super golden gate. So